deep reasons why they wanted to work in my lab, and Mike stood out because he had founded the archery team at UC Berkeley and was absolutely fascinated by elastic energy storage. And I thought, you know, no, he has no training whatsoever in the actual project, but somehow that knowledge of that, in, you know, that fascination of a phenomenon probably will do him well with the project. And that turned out to be totally correct. And before I knew it, this won't surprise some of you, he was learning how to program, computer program, which he hadn't done before. And this was a big eye-opener because he suddenly realized he'd love to do that. He's running a materials testing machine. And during all this, I actually wasn't even at Berkeley because I was having a baby in Germany. And so I got to know him through Skype during that year. And when he graduated, we moved to UMass, and I heard that he was making awesome music videos from his bedroom in California after he graduated. And I was talking to someone at UMass, I'm like, this has got to stop. So he got himself a year of funding at UMass through a really neat program to train people to get into the professoriate, pretty unusual. So he got himself funding that year, and the next thing you know, he's a graduate student with me at UMass, and he got a Department of Energy Computational Sciences Fellowship that funded him almost his entire time in graduate school, tapping into this fascination with computer programming and modeling and computational approaches to biology. And then, lo and behold, after all the trouble moving to Massachusetts, I had another baby, which he had to survive me not being around for, and then I decided to move to Duke, and this would be a third move. And we had a lot of conversations, and the agreement that we came to was that he would come to Duke if I didn't move again while he was in my lab. So down he came, and he's had an incredibly successful time since he's been here. He published the first chapter of his dissertation this past year, and also has been awarded a prestigious NSF postdoc to work up at Brown University, hence why everything has to get done right now, because he's heading off to Brown, I believe, next month to start up work on vertebrate elastic systems. So without further ado, Mike and the big day.
Also, you didn't warn me during my undergraduate interview that you would be on Skype. That was like the scariest thing.
Yeah, you're in my lab, it'll be very well virtually, unfortunately.
Alright, well, thank you so much for showing up today. It's super cold and right at the start of Thanksgiving, so I really appreciate everyone being here. And also, most of you have never heard me give a talk before. Most of you know, like, don't know what I do, so I'm really excited to have this hour to really tell, to show you what I've been up to. And I thought I'd start off really simply with a question that fascinated me from the very start, which is how are bioelastic systems analyzed? It sounds like a very simple question, but once you see what goes into it, it gets more and more complicated, and it's something that I've struggled with throughout my dissertation. But let's start off with just like looking at some animals. So this is a trap jaw man. I don't know if you can see the little mandibles that are pushing onto the ground right now, but once this video starts playing, you'll see that those mandibles close and propel that ant into the air. And keep in mind that this was captured at 3,000 frames per second and it's being played back at 30. So this is like 100 times slowed down. So in real life, this happens nearly instantaneously. You wouldn't be able to see it. And we'll just finish the acrobatics. And everyone wants to see what happens when it lands. Suspense. So one of the questions I always have, well, you know, how do you study, how do you learn about the system and how it does that? So to give you another example, here's a veiled chameleon. On this side of the screen, there's a cricket that is taped onto a piece of paper. And again, this is slowed down. But what you can see is that very rapidly that tongue will project, well, towards this side of the screen and grab that cricket. Which is pretty impressive. And actually, there was a study that came out that found one of these chameleons that could fit in the palm of your hand that was able to generate 54 horsepower. And that is about the same horsepower as a commercial dirt bike. So that much power in your hand, just completely amazing. All right, and just to throw another example out there, this is a much smaller scale, but the flea jump. it's been shown that for some species of flea, for some species of flea that they can jump anywhere from 200 to 300 times their body length. And just this crazy, this incredible movement of a bioelastic system. And so when you go try to answer this question, how are bioelastic systems analyzed? Something that people usually do is they look at these motions and these movements, and they measure how much power it takes to make those movements. So for example, the trap jump ant that we just saw, 150,000 watts per kilogram. A chameleon can get up to 41,000 watts per kilogram, and the flea 10,000 watts per kilogram. Now those numbers may not mean anything to you, but just to give you a reference, this is an estimate for the most powerful muscle that has been measured. It's 120 watts per kilogram. And if you notice, the power it takes to do these movements is orders of magnitude larger than the most powerful muscle. And the way that these animals can do these movements is by inserting a spring into their system, by having the muscle connected to a spring. And just to show you mathematically how that works, let's just quickly think about power, the definition of power. It's the amount of work per the amount of time, right? And if you think about a spring, right, and if you think about taking that spring and compressing it very slowly, say on the order of like a second, once you release that, that spring will recoil back to its original position or even past it in a much quicker time scale. And so if you look at the conservation of energy or the conservation of work, the work in is equal to the work out. So work is more or less constant throughout this entire thing. What's changing here is time, right? So when you release something very quickly, the time goes down. So if you have constant work, smaller time, you get larger power, hence power amplification. And so when you look at systems like these and you look at these numbers, this is one way that you can study bioelastic systems. By comparing the power that these organisms are using to generate their movement, comparing them to muscle, and saying whether or not there's a spring, or whether or not there has to be a spring in that system. And that is a very solid question. It's very foundational. It's super important. But what it does do is lead to more questions. For example, what is the spring? And this might seem trivial, but we'll get into some examples of exactly what I mean by what is a spring. And so there's a hierarchy of questions, and another type of question you can ask is how does a spring work mechanically, right? So how does the physics or the engineering of the work of the spring work? Can you understand what's going on? And finally, this is what I regard as like a top tier level question in terms of studying bioelastic systems, is how does the spring work in its biological context? So again, if this is the physics and engineering of the spring, this the very top level is how are these organisms using that spring, and how does that change our understanding of the mechanics? And so just to give a simple example, right, we already answered this question for three systems, right? Is there a spring? We looked at the power, and we were able to tell that yes, answer this question, there is a spring. And so as we move up this triangle, I'm gonna probably say march up this triangle or march up this period for the rest of the talk, but as we move up this triangle, and try to see how many studies have actually addressed what is the spring. We see that in the chameleon, we have a pretty good hypothesis of what the spring is. In the flea, we have a pretty good hypothesis of what the spring is. In terms of the trap jump ant, like we have no idea what that spring is. Like there's a one-liner in a discussion of a paper that says the elastic energy storage probably occurs in the tendon, in the head capsule, or the mandible. So everything that's involved. So we have really no idea. And so as I continue going up this triangle and answering how does the spring work mechanically, I actually can't. This is as far as we go because none of these questions have been really resolved fully in these systems. And I think that's actually a really interesting thing because this is pretty representative of the state of the field of elastic biomechanics, where if we actually scale the area of this pyramid or these triangles to show which of these questions have been addressed in the literature, we see something that looks more like this, where some studies, you know, get past where is there a spring to what is a spring, and even fewer get to the mechanics, and even fewer get to how biology affects it. And I think that this is not where we should be in the field, just because answering these questions goes along the spectrum from getting information that is study specific, learning things about the things that you're testing. Whereas if you're answering the questions up above, you're actually getting towards the universal principles. You're getting towards ideas and mechanisms that are applicable to all elastic systems in biology. And that's super important. Just to take a step back and realize why it's so important.